Still we can make it better, throwing all your cares away. Can I talk my shit again? Can I talk my shit again? I can't believe I'm back up in this motherfucker. I'ma be late though. I gotta figure out what I'm finna wear. Yeah. The rock is definitely in the building.
See boobs! I don't need to see tits! You don't need to show me an image of a naked woman! God!
On a vocal string, he sings crap beautifully, don't you agree? Don't you agree? And John Bryan on the keys right now. And Warren Campbell on the keys right now. So they ask me, why you call it late registration, yeah?
Okay. I just want to say, I'm not even super familiar with who this broad is, but, like, can she please just, like, leave the internet entirely? It's like, just kill yourself. Like, oh my gosh, leave me alone. Like, you're so disgusting to me. Your entire existence disgusts me, and I hate it so much, and you should die, okay? Not me. I'm just pointing it out. Like, I'm literally just telling you, like, you know, like, they're doing this, and I'm the one being called a homosexual. Like, hey, I don't forget to take pictures of your balls like Obama does, but, It's not even like, look, I do hate women, but, like, it's not even, like, just a hate. It's, like, these specific people, like, should, I want them dead, you know, as Donald Trump said, you know, death penalty, bring it forth, you know?
I think I'm unmuted now. I think it's good. Look, you have to tell me. Let me know in the chat if you can hear me, because I don't know. I legitimately don't know if you can hear me right now. It tells me you can hear me. I'm looking at OBS right now, and it says that there is audio coming out, but I never know. You never know with this stuff. I'm a boomer at heart. You know, I'm 19 years old. I'm too old for this stuff. But welcome back. Hopefully, if you can hear me, welcome back to the Big Nick Show. We have a great show for you tonight. As always, we have a great guest on, a new guest on, a great guy. And before we get into that, though, real quick, as always, make sure you like and subscribe to the channel. It helps support the channel, and it's 100% free. But if you do want to help support the channel financially, you can always donate, leave a super chat over on Entropy, because we're not monetized on YouTube. And you can leave a question or comment over there, and we will get to it at the end of the show. We'll always get to all the super chats. We'll try to get some of the questions in the chat if you leave them, but I don't know if I'm going to get to all of them. So if you want to make sure if you have a question or comment that you want read on the air, make sure you leave it in a super chat, and we will always get to that near the end of the show before we end it. I haven't been streaming in a little while. This is the return of the Big Nick Show, I guess, because last year I stopped streaming for a period of time. I was getting, you know, strikes on YouTube, so I couldn't stream, and I had a lot of personal stuff going on in my life. I was really busy too, and I just didn't have time to do a lot of, like, set up a stream like this. I would do Instagram live streams every once in a while because it was easy. I could just turn on my phone and stuff like that. But trying to get back into the groove of this thing, so I'm gonna check the YouTube chat right now, and I just pray. I just pray everyone can hear me. Okay. Thank you. everyone. I was hoping I wasn't like just talking and no one can hear me. But anyways, I think that covers everything. One quick thing though is I just realized YouTube doesn't allow me to put links in my description for some reason. They won't allow me to do it, so I can't link. You won't find anything linked over there. But I will show the important links on screen when we get to those, especially Kyle's links as well, where you can follow him at. I will show those up on screen, and maybe one of the mods will link it in the chat as well, for you, so you guys can find his stuff if you don't follow him already. But anyways, enough of my yapping here. We have an important guest on. There he is, this Mr. Sexy Mustache himself. How are we doing, Kyle?
How's it going, guys? How's it going? It's good to be here. I've been dreaming about coming on the Big Nick show for years.
For years. I don't know why. I wouldn't tell you why. You know, I met you at AmFest, and you came up to me, and you were asking me, well, I'm not going to come on the show. I'm like, I don't know why you want to, but, you know, I'll have you on. But I do appreciate it, because I said something to you about this earlier, but I just hate going to people and like asking them, like, can you please come on my show? You know, so I appreciated that someone for once came to me and asked me that, so I didn't have to go and do it myself. But I'm glad to have you on.
Yeah, it's good to be here. Second favorite show on the internet.
Well, I appreciate that. Real quick, before we get into anything, just, you know, I want to hear what you have to say. Let people know who you are if they don't know already. What do you do? Why are you so? Why are you on the show? Like, what's the purpose of you being on the show? What do you do?
Well, I'm an undercover journalist. I guess I would call myself a journalist now for legal reasons, because you have a lot more protections calling yourself a journalist. But really, I'm just an undercover investigator. A lot of you may have seen my stuff as far as going undercover into the Freemasons and recording an entire ritual for the Freemasons and posting it online. That garnished a ton of views. I've also gone undercover with the ADL, recorded them on a little dinner date, and talked to them about how they control social media. And I've exposed Ray Epps. I went to his house. So just a lot of undercover stuff that I've exposed over the years.
Very nice. So what got you into undercover stuff? Because I've always been, I don't want to sound like I'm dick riding or anything here, but I've always kind of been a fan of your stuff. I always thought you were kind of underrated when it came to, like, you know, people on Cozy and whatnot, because I've always been a big fan of like undercover investigations, things like that. When I was younger, I was always a big fan of Project Veritas, James O'Keefe, things like that. And when I saw your stuff back in, I think it was 2022, you know, I was a big fan of yours as well. But what really got you into it? You know, what started it all?
I think what started it all is 2 years ago during AmFest, TPUSA had an after party, and it was super degenerate. They brought in a bunch of strippers, and there were people having sex on the dance floor, and it was super degenerate. It was really bad optics for the conservatives as a whole, even if you're not really that far right, as most of the TPUSA people aren't. But it was such bad optics, and I had so many people there sending me videos, so I compiled it all together and posted it online in a nice presentation. And luckily, I got two of the TPUSA people that were hosting it fired. So it made some political change. And after I saw how much that blew up and it was so successful that I just continued to do more stuff. Ray Epps was my next big project. As soon as I found out he lived in Arizona, I drove over to his house and caught him sitting outside on his golf cart, asked him if he's a federal informant. He drove off and didn't want to answer the question. So that blew up also. And so a lot of the stuff I'm posting, it goes very viral, and it doesn't always get me anything. Like, I'm not really getting much by going to Ray Epps' house and asking him if he's a federal informant, because he didn't answer it. But it gets people to ask questions and look a little bit deeper. And that's really my main goal, is to get people to ask questions.
Yeah, I remember, I think, going back to the TPUSA party, what was that called? It was, there was a specific name.
It was the Grand Young Party.
Yeah, that's what it was. Because that's actually we talked. We didn't like talk. We didn't like meet a lot. But I talked to you briefly around that time because I knew people. I wasn't at the party, but I knew people who were there, and I was just as equally disgusted about it. And you know, I wasn't like some big name or anything, but I was doing I was doing what I could, you know, to help uncover some of this stuff. And I actually, that's where I started talking to Chief Trumpster as well. Cause he was doing that kind of stuff as well. But I remember that cause we talked briefly around that time, about it. But yeah, I didn't know that's where it all started. I just remember you were a part of that as well because it was like disgusting stuff, but, it was Lance Videos and, Joe Bazzuari, if I remember correctly, were the two goons behind it. I actually saw Joe Bazzuari at, AmFest. He was running the, like Texans for Israel booth there, and he gave me an Israeli flag, but yeah, so I remember that. But now, when it comes to the undercover stuff, would you recommend? Would this be something you recommend for like other people to get into, or what do you recommend people do with all this information? Because you've got, we're going to get into some of the stories, but you've gone, like I said, you said the Ray Epps thing, you went undercover at a drag queen event, you went undercover at SatanCon, most recently you went undercover in a Masonic lodge. Like, what do you recommend people do with all of this information? Like, what is the purpose of all this? Like, what do you want people to do when they see this information?
Just ask questions. I mean, when we go into the Freemason Lodge and we expose all this stuff for everyone to see, it's not really, it already existed. So it's not like we're getting any more information out there to the public. We just want them to ask a bunch of questions on like what's going on, why they're doing this and so on. So, I mean, the more questions we can get people to ask, the better. Even if we're not uncovering new information, we're just getting new talking points out there.
And I apologize real quick. I actually just looked at the stream and it looks like the video of it is kind of lagging. I apologize for that. There's not much I can do. I'm running this off of an old laptop, so I apologize for that. I'll try my best. I'll try to stop jumping around, I guess, on tabs here, but hopefully
I think it's just your camera. It just looks like your voice is a little delayed, but everything else looks good.
Okay. At least I don't know. Hopefully it's all good, but yeah, so would you recommend like younger people, cause you're a little older. How old are you, if you don't mind me asking?
I'm 30.
30, which I had heard something like you were older, like 20, like upwards of like 25. I was like, wait, I thought you were like a younger guy. I'm not going to lie. You look kind of younger. And I was like, wait, this guy's like 30. Like what? So yeah, you are 30. What do you recommend? Do you recommend someone, you know, a younger person, like 18, 19, 20, do you recommend they maybe try to do similar things as well in their areas, or?
I do. Right now I'm doing kind of a public outreach, I guess you could say, where I'm trying to find different journalists or different people that will go undercover for me in all 50 states. Because that really seems to be the problem is logistics. I can't fly to New York to go explore these Jewish tunnels underground. I can't fly to Florida to investigate some of this stuff. So I really rely on the public, and that's kind of what James O'Keefe does. He finds these reporters, these female reporters, to go on these undercover dates for people. And so I'm really trying to do the same. I have starting to grow my my list of colleagues for different states. I have people in Michigan that went undercover for me, and so the more people I meet, the more people that are willing to do this stuff, the better. I mean, even if it's not through me, even if they're posting it on their own social media, that's great. The more people that we can get talking, the better.
Yeah, because I mean, I don't know if I would be able to do it, dude. Like I enjoy this kind of stuff. I don't know if I would have the balls to do stuff like this. I don't know. I get nervous going and talking at like school board meetings and stuff. I don't know if I could keep my cool undercover, you know. But
yeah, it gets really hard at times. I mean, when I went undercover with the ADL, that was so awkward because towards the end they started to catch on that we weren't there for what we were saying we were there for. We went undercover at the ADL. We told them we were going under, we were going to meet them for a dinner to potentially become donors for the ADL. We were going to donate a check of $80,000. So they jumped on the meeting with us. They showed up at the restaurant. They wanted to hear what we had to say and answer our questions. So they were answering everything. But then they started to ask questions. Our story had a lot of holes in it because we weren't as prepared as I'd like to be. And so they started to catch on. And then finally, one of the ADL employees, she went and excused herself to the bathroom. And she was blowing up the other girl's phone saying, hey, we need to go. These guys aren't who they say they are. So it was really, really awkward towards the end of it when they started to catch on.
I was going to ask that because, like, you know, you see with stuff like all the time, like, for example, Project Veritas, one of the things I always hear about them is like, is it fake? You know, how do people like, how do you like set up these interviews where like, you like, well, I have a question, like, how do you, the whole camera placement and everything, are you sitting, I'm assuming you're not standing there holding the phones, like, how do the, I don't know, it's all strange. Like, can you explain like how you would set up, like, for example, let's say you and I were like out to dinner, you're going to record me. Like, how would you try to set that up, if you don't mind me asking?
Well, there's good technology out there. They make a little hidden camera button. It's a button that goes on your dress shirt, and it's disguised just like any other button, but really has a microphone and a camera built into it, and it shoots at 720p. So not the greatest quality, but most of the times hiding in plain sight does it justice. So I'll just put the phone in my front pocket and just have the camera lens just poking out, and people just think it's my phone sitting in my pocket. They don't expect that they're being recorded. So, I mean, hiding in plain sight seems to work.
Yeah, I mean, I didn't assume you were, like, standing there holding your phone like this, but it was just, because I see a lot of people criticize things. They'll say stuff like, you know, like some Project Veritas videos, whatever, like fake, because, like, how are they recording this person? How does this person not know they're being recorded kind of thing? And I was always interested how this works. Like, is it their phones? Is it some other, like, hidden thing? You know, do they have it just sitting on the table kind of thing? I didn't really know how that worked, but that's very interesting. Bro's got the spy, you know, tech there, little button camera. It's crazy. But so you've done a lot of different things. How long of a time period do these things usually take? Like, from the moment you, like, set up, or, you know, if it's an interview, you're trying to meet someone, you know, how long does it take you to do that to the time you publish the video? Like, is it a long period of time? Do you try to get it out quick, or is it a longer period of time, or how long do these things usually last?
You know, I wish I had the ability to pump it out quick, but I'm a perfectionist, so I like to sit down and meticulously edit and make sure it's perfect for display for the algorithm, because, I mean, everything nowadays is all about statistics, right? So you have to have everything perfect if it really needs to go viral. So, for example, the Freemason one, I mean, that one took the longest because I had to befriend a bunch of Freemasons and earn my way in. That one took years. But as something as simple as the ADL video, that was about a month of communication until we got to sit down for a meeting. And then after we sat down for a meeting and I recorded it, it took about a week to edit it and post it. I try and only post on Tuesday, Wednesdays, and Thursdays because it's the middle of the week. It's during the news cycle. If you're posting things on Friday, let's say I get this viral clip that I want to post and everyone hear about. If I post it on a Friday, they'll talk about it on Friday, but Saturday and Sunday, everyone goes home. So nobody's really talking about that type of stuff. So it's important when you have these giant news breaks, you got to post them on the correct days.
Yeah, I mean, hey, and I will say obviously you know what you're doing, because it clearly does work, because I know people who aren't, you know, America First or any of that. I think I told you this, my dad, who's like kind of, you know, I'm not trying to hate on my dad. I love my dad, but he's like kind of like a boomer kind of guy. He's not like, you know, AF or anything like that. But he even knew who you were. He knew who you were. He said he saw your Freemason stuff. So, you know, clearly it's work. Clearly, you know what you're doing, because I know people who know who you are, who don't even know what AF is, you know. So clearly, you know how to do these things. Real quick here, I want to ask you about this, because I remember this was like this is one that I remember here. I'll just play this in the background here, but you went undercover. This was like 2 years ago, I want to say. I think it was like 2020. There you go, 2022, I mean. You went undercover in the Satanic Temple Convention in Arizona. How did that go? Like, what did you decide? You just saw it, decided to do it, or what went behind that? What was the thinking behind that?
Well, I didn't even know what was going on until a buddy who was in town visiting from Canada, he was staying at the hotel, and all of a sudden he starts seeing these freaks walking around the hotel lobby with like pride pins on their shirts and pride flags and horns on their head. And they were super satanic. And then he asked the hotel lady, hey, what's going on here? And she said, oh, it's the Satanic Convention. He's like, what kind of hotel am I staying in? And in fact, we looked into it. The hotel is like, they're one of the biggest LGBT, pro-LGBT hotels in the country. They host a lot of events and conventions for, I guess you would say, LGBT-affiliated events, which I guess you would say the Satanic Convention is an LGBT event because that's basically one of their main tenants. Mm-hmm. But yeah, when I went there, a buddy of mine tried to get in just to cause a scene and was kicked out immediately. Police were there checking to see if they had their vaccinations before they could enter. So my friend didn't have his vaccination card, so they were like, nope, you can't come in. And they had a police officer there. So I decided to sneak in undercover after hours and go in there and set up a bunch of books, some Catholic books, some Christian books all around the lobby, so that when they would come in the morning, they'd see all these books everywhere. So it was a pretty fun time.
Have you ever been, like, when you're undercover at, like, these events, because you also went to, like, a drag event at one point, too. Has anyone ever, like, recognized you, like, known, like, oh, this guy, you know, is, like, a mole, you know, or something like that? Has anyone ever, like, have you been confronted at these events when you're trying to be, like, undercover?
No, surprisingly not. And that's kind of, that's a fear of mine for sure, because I know eventually it's going to happen. I mean, James O'Keefe, I feel like he's too well known to really go undercover and do a lot of these types of stuff. That's why he has a lot of people that do it for him. So that's kind of the goal. I mean, I don't want to do this stuff on my own all the time. I'd like to have other people that are helping me out and doing stuff where I can't fill the shoes.
Yeah, because I was thinking about that too. It's like, you know, at some point, especially if you're getting more popular, especially after the Masonic stuff, I feel like they're going to be on the lookout, especially on these certain events. Yeah. So yeah, there
the
is
big thing is I wear a hat a lot of the places, so or a lot of on photo, on video, on interviews and stuff. So when I'm out in public and I'm doing these undercover stuff, I just take the hat off. Nobody recognizes me.
So at the Satanic Convention, what was like the worst? I mean, this is obviously it's satanic, so it's going to be a lot of bad stuff. What was like the worst? From what you can remember, what was like the worst thing you saw there? You witnessed there?
It was a while ago, but I think I remember they had a class. They were teaching a class where they invited everyone in, and they taught everyone how to get abortions in states that it was banned. I think they were teaching you how to do at home abortions. It was very weird stuff. I don't remember all the details, but I vaguely remember that they had like a at home abortion how to group. It was very weird.
And I have the video. I don't. You can't see it, but on the YouTube stream, I have the video muted and it's playing behind you. I hope it's muted. Gosh, that would be bad. It is muted. Okay. But I just have it playing behind you. And what's funny, I'm just looking at this now. I forgot about this. Like, you found out like multiple people there were like registered sex offenders.
Oh yeah, yeah.
Which I mean is not shouldn't come as a surprise, you know. It's but it is a little funny nonetheless. But so there is that. Like I said, I mentioned this before too. You did go undercover. Let's get off of this. You did go undercover at a drag event. Now, how did this go? Because I haven't gone to a drag event, but I did do something similar at one point last year where I went to a. I went to a pride event and I kind of just, I was kind of walking around documenting like kind of the stuff that was there. It was very, very bad stuff. But like, what was this like for you? What was, you know, what did you think about that? You know?
Man, that was weird. I the reason why I went is I found out that this lady, well, this man dressed as a lady, was going to be speaking at a drag book reading show for children. In Tucson, Arizona on, I can't remember the day, but it was a Thursday. And so what I did was I looked into this man and I found out that he does a drag event at a bar 12 hours before he does this drag queen story hour. And so I went to the bar and just recorded everything that was going on just to show the parallel between what this man dressed as a woman is going to be doing 12 hours before speaking to children. And it was a sex trivia night at this gay bar. Where this man, all these drag queens dressed up and got the whole bar to play this sex trivia. And then 12 hours later, he drives to Tucson and a couple hours away and reads storybooks to children. So it just shows how like perverted these people are. They're speaking They're doing sex trivia, and then the next day they're speaking to children.
Yeah, I mean, I went under. I wasn't like under. I kind of. I mean, I didn't really have to go like undercover kind of thing. I just kind of walked around this pride event that was happening downtown in my city, and it was really like I had to go home early because I generally like felt sick. The longer I was there, I was getting like I was getting a migraine like just being out there, and I had to go home because I was like I can't take this. But they had things like there was. And this is all ages. Like these are kids there. Like there are young children, very young children, and they had people openly like walking around with like bondage gear on, and just, you know. And there was trannies, and there was cross dressers, and they were selling sex toys out in the open, and it was repulsive. It was the worst thing ever. And then you had like the local school, you know, the community school. Had a booth there. You had the library had a booth there. Like all of these, like pub, all these like local, you know, places. Just like all were okay with it, and it is just really disturbing and just disgusting stuff. What do you, how do you recommend? Like, what do you think needs to happen to put a stop to this stuff?
Man, at this point, we've tried cultural pressure, calling these places. I mean, we've shut down a few by mass calling them, calling the venue and letting them know what they're hosting there, and getting the venue to pull the event. But they're still, I mean, they're finding events that are pro-LGBT, so they're letting it slide. At this point, the only thing really to stop it is legislation. We need a strong America First leader who will go in there and put a stop to it. I mean, it's not that hard. There's already laws in place. I mean, laws that protect our children. All we need to do is just execute them. Execute the laws.
Execute the law. Yeah, obviously. but yeah, because it's like I've talked about this in the show. I live in Indiana, so it's a fairly red state. I'm not gonna dox where exactly I live, but in the state of Indiana, it's a fairly red state. Like. Red for a very long time, like, you know, 16 plus points for Trump, you know, very, it's not a swing state, you know, it's a very red state. And I live in a fairly red area, and I even deal with these issues. You know, it's the schools, you know, the school boards, they allow, I kind of did my own little, you know, investigation into this stuff, but I found out they were doing, if you went on the website, you could look under like after school clubs and stuff. And like on the bottom, there was a little like after school gay and tranny club up there. And the group that was hosting it, I can't remember exactly the name, but they were, if you go to their website, they're talking about how they're like teaching kids to like, you know, how not to talk about it to your parents kind of thing. Cause they might be like hostile towards it. And this is just happening, and people talk about it like it's something happening in you know, California, you know, maybe Arizona or New York or, you know, Illinois, things like that. But it's everywhere, you know. Again, I'm you know, proof of that. Like, I live in a very red area, and it's still happening here as well. So something needs to happen, and you know, I don't think there's a lot of older people who say stuff like there's no political solution. You know, we just have to. Just a deal with it kind of thing. It's like, no, there's solutions. It's just, you know, it's gonna take some work. It's gonna take some time to get the right people in the right positions, and things can be solved. It's just we have to have people willing to stand up against it until it's solved. And so there's that. One other thing, obviously you touched on this as well, was you confronted Ray Epps, who was the big Jan 6 guy who told everyone to go into the Capitol and storm the Capitol. And he was telling people this, like, you know, back in, it was the day before. So he was like telling people to go like storm the Capitol, before, January 6th even happened, you know, like the night before. There's video of him saying stuff like that. So what really was, like, did you just find out he lived there and you just decided to go down? Like, how, was it just like out of the blue kind of thing? Like, how did this?
Yeah, I was talking to a good buddy of mine, and he told me that Ray Epps lived in Arizona. And I was like, wow, I had no clue. So I reached out to my friend who saw him the day before on January 5th, my friend Grayson Arnold. And we jumped in the car. We drove down there. We thought maybe we'd knock on the door or something. It turns out he owns a wedding venue, or he owned one. And so we drove around in circles around the area just to see if maybe there was a better way we could approach it. And all of a sudden, we see him drive by on a golf cart. So we just parked, hopped out of the car, and we asked him if he was a federal informant, and he just refused to answer and stormed off into his giant compound that he had.
Now I'm just noticing this because I have the video up here on Instagram, and I forgot you did this. You said in the description of this. I also interviewed his daughter about his allegations on a 30-minute Zoom call, which can be found hosted on the APU, American Populist Union YouTube channel. So I forgot about that. But no, so you interviewed his daughter, and what did his daughter have to say about him?
Well, his daughter hates his guts. I mean, I don't know how legitimate this is, but she says he sexually abused her and treated her like trash throughout her entire life. And so he kind of disowned her, and she ran off and got married and had a bunch of children. And now she's Christian and conservative and all that. But her father, Ray Epps, is she has nothing nice to say about him. So she just was given a lot of background information. She hasn't really been in contact with him for the last 5 or so years. So she wasn't able to give too much pertinent information, but she was able to talk a lot about like the backstory on how Ray Epps was raised and what kind of family life he has and how he got into the military and how he got into the Oath Keepers and all that. But yeah, she's an interesting lady for sure.
I forgot about that. Now that you say that, I forgot. Like, yeah, she like claimed that she was like abusing her and
Oh
stuff.
yeah, and let me say, this video was the number one most viewed video on the APU's website until they took it down because it was too America first for them.
I guess so. It's not even APU anymore. It's what even is it? It's like I think it's American Virtue. And I don't even
It's
know if they
dead.
is it. Yeah, I forgot. It was American Virtue, and then it died. They all, disbanded, and Vince Dow jumped ship before it really all went downhill, and then David Carlson took it over, and then he blocked me on Twitter too, which is very unfortunate. I thought this was the decade of David Carlson, but apparently not. But yeah, one and then obviously, it's the big story here. The whole Masonic thing. That was really, I mean, that was your most recent story that you did. And I think we talked a little about this in person. I asked you about this in person because I was curious about this. How, because you're Catholic, and how, so just to everyone here, because we talked about this in person, but just how, are you supposed to be doing, is it okay to be doing this, like, while, would you recommend other people do this, if they're Catholics or things like that? Because you're not supposed to be, like, messing around with this secret, society kind of stuff here. So what did you, would you recommend other people go undercover at Masonic lodges and do take part in the rituals and whatnot?
No, in fact, a lot of people have asked me. They say, "Hey, I have a Masonic lodge near me. Should I do the same thing as you?" And I say, "No, 100%, definitely not. You're not going to get anything good out of it. I did it before I was Catholic. I did it before I was baptized, before I was confirmed. The video was actually, even though I posted it in December, I actually filmed it in January, and that was before I was Catholic. I converted and was baptized in February." And March, and of course, I've had conversations about it. And yeah, you do. I mean, Masonry, you have to reject Christ to be involved with it. And so, unfortunately, yeah, being so deep into it and to expose it, I had probably had to do things that weren't good. And that's why I wouldn't say anyone else to try it. Now, of course, thankfully, now I'm Catholic. I go to Mass every Sunday, so definitely, hopefully, a saved man, but. Yeah, I wouldn't recommend anyone else to do it for sure.
Because I have this large Masonic lodge downtown and near me, and it's, I don't know, I've always it was always strange. I didn't know I didn't really know what it was when I was younger. I was like, what is, what are the Masons and stuff like that? But the more I've, as I've gotten older, it's like, oh, that's really bad. Like, that shouldn't be there, kind of thing. But yeah, so you talked about, I mean, this was how long? Like, you had said you were doing this for like years because you had to befriend these people, and like, what was really, I mean, I don't know how much you can really get into it, but how, like, what was the process over the years? Like, you were doing this. Like, how far back does this go where you were, like, had to befriend these people?
It started about, I'd say about 3 to 5 years ago. I started going in there and I was asking questions. I was like, hey, I want to join. I joined because this was before I was really conservative. Well, I mean, I've always been conservative, but this was before I was really into America First, before I was really understanding and open to a lot of the things that I am now. But when I started going in there, my main goal was to expose the Illuminati, because I thought the Freemasons were running the world. And so I went in there and I was like, hey, I want to join. And so my requirement was I had to go to lunch or dinner every single week for a year. And so I went to dinner with them every week, every Tuesday, 7 o'clock. We sat down and we had dinner and they got to know me. Once they trusted me enough, they did a vote and voted me in. And so then my plan was starting to work. So I was just waiting. I stopped going after they let me in. I stopped going for about 3 years. I didn't contact any of them, didn't talk to any of them. I wanted to wait so there was a little bit of a separation, so that one day I wouldn't just come in and they'd be super suspicious of me or anything. So after waiting for several years, luckily, all these older guys that kind of got me into it had all died off. So in January of this year, of last year, I went in with a camera and I was like, hey, I'm back. I just want to see what this is all about. I'm still kind of interested. But I went in with a camera and I recorded their most sacred ritual, the third degree ritual, which is a Master Mason ritual for the Blue Lodge. Now, you may have heard that there's a 33rd degree and all that, and there is. But the way it's structured is, in the Blue Lodge, for a Freemason to become a Master Mason, they have to go through first, second, and third degree. Third degree is the highest degree. It's a Master Mason. After you get the third degree, you can choose to go to another branch, like the Scottish Rite, which takes you all the way up to the 33rd degree. Now, that 33rd degree isn't, you're not really learning much more. What they're doing is they're filling in the gaps between the first, second, third degree. Mm-hmm. So even if you're a 33rd degree, you're no higher than the Master Mason in the third degree lodge. And then you can also choose to go into the Shriners or the York Rite, or they have tons of different types of rites you can join. But I just decided to expose the main Blue Lodge. I didn't want to go any further because the more I learned about it, the more I realized what I was doing was wrong. And then after going and really watching it and hearing what people had to say, that's when I started getting into Catholicism. So I started going to catechism class and finally was converted to Catholic.
Well, I'm glad.
So it was a long process, long journey.
Because I assumed, like, again, this is how I didn't know, because I assumed it was, like, you know, a couple months at the most. But no, this is, like you said, it's like a three-year thing, which is it's pretty crazy. What would you say, and because there's a lot, you did it in, like, a series, it was, like, a four-part series, what would you say was the worst thing that you went, what was the weirdest thing that you went? Because it's about a lot of, like, symbolism and these things. Very weird, very strange, especially for an outsider. You know, I don't really know anything about, like, their a lot of their rituals and stuff. Like, what would you say is, like, the weirdest thing that you saw there? Because a lot of weird stuff, but, like, what is the weirdest thing you would say?
Yeah, that's why it's hard, is because a lot of people look at it and they're like, oh, this is just boomer, this is like a play that the boomers are putting on to make themselves happy. But really, I mean, they have, what they're doing is basically performing a ritual that's existed for hundreds and hundreds of years. I mean, they trace it back to the Bible. I mean, it really just comes from the Talmud, and it's all Jewish theater at this point. But it comes from the main story of Solomon's temple and the workers that Solomon appointed to build the temple. So as far as the weirdest thing, it's probably the fact that the whole ritual is a mock execution and a resurrection. The whole thing, I mean, it's all the little symbols that they do. They have the three lights lit up on the altar. It's to reject the Trinity. Everything they do is basically a mockery of the Catholic Church. It's all, I mean, Freemasonry is the antithesis to Catholicism in a way. So I'd say that's probably the weirdest, just the overall ritual being a resurrection ritual.
Yeah, because I had known, what's funny was I have been doing research into these kinds of things for a little bit now, because I'm working on this long form video project to have stuff to do with, like, you know, sex trafficking and, you know, these rituals and whatnot. And I was trying not to, and I'm not that I'm against it, but I was trying not to make the whole video, you know, just about Jews, you know. I was trying not to make it all, I wanted to, like, bridge a couple other things, you know. I was like, I don't want to be, like, the only focus of the video. And we started to get things like, you know, Masonic rituals, you know, Aleister Crowley, the kind of stuff. And what's funny is, like, but it's like, if you researched, like, you know, the Freemasons, you know, it all goes back to Jews, you know, and it's very strange, you know. That's all I'll say about it. It's weird stuff when they seem to pop up in a lot of these places, but yeah. So a lot of people, one thing that's attributed a lot of the times to the Masons is child sex trafficking and whatnot. I'm assuming you didn't. I'm assuming you didn't witness any of that. But do you think that stuff's happening at these local lodges, like at yours? Do you think they're doing this kind of stuff?
I guarantee. Yeah. I mean, they say that the higher up degrees, they do weirdish and weirder stuff. So I totally believe it. I mean, if you look at the Shriners, every Shriner has to be a Freemason. So anytime you meet a Shriner with those red fez caps, I mean, if you look at the main thing that they invest in is the Shriners Children's Hospital.
Yeah, yeah.
So they have the largest children's hospital where they donate millions and millions of dollars every year. I mean, you got to ask why. I mean, even working on my local lodge, they would say things like, oh, hey, everyone pitch in $20. We're going to go buy the children across the street spikes bicycles. And then they would have a Freemason lodge meeting where they would all go to the school and they would give bicycles at the school assembly, the elementary school assembly. So in a weird way, yeah, they're trying to normalize themselves in children's lives. But I mean, yeah, I'm sure there's more nefarious things happening there for sure.
Yeah, because I believe I forget a lot of these things. Like I said, I'm an old guy here. I forget a lot of this stuff here. I will say this just to show you how old I am. My birthday was December, was on the 29th, and I couldn't remember. Someone asked me how old I was, and I couldn't remember how old I was. I had to, like, pull out a calculator because I just couldn't remember. But wasn't you know Aleister Crowley, right? The big Freemason guy from, like, the 1900s or so. He talked about how he got in trouble, as far as I remember, with the Masons because he said, like, didn't he talk about how the biggest secret of, like, Freemasonry was that, like, you could, like, rape and, like, kill kids and, like, drink their blood and shit to, like, make you live forever or whatnot. And it was some very strange thing like that, and they got mad at him for it. They said, you can't be talking about that kind of stuff. But it's very, people see Masonry, like a Masonic lodge, as just, like, some joke, you know, just the thing that, you know, your uncle does on the weekends, you know. It's just some group that he goes to. But if you look at the history of this stuff, it's very, very strange stuff. You know, very, very evil.
Yeah,
stuff.
The way I look at it is, a lot of these boomers, you can go ask any random Freemason that's walking down the street, and he's not going to necessarily be an evil guy. He's doing evil practices inside of the lodge, but I mean, he might be a good guy, like genuinely. But he doesn't really know what he's getting into. A lot of these Freemasons, it's the same way. I mean, you could watch that ritual and be like, oh, well, that kind of looks a little interesting. But really, I mean, it's a bigger picture thing. They're giving you this key, or they're giving you this lock, this box that's locked, and they're teaching you all the symbols and what the symbols mean, but they're not teaching you what the symbols do. So you get a square and a compass and you say, this is what represents man, and this is what represents women, and this is the divine masculine and feminine energy, and all this like sex magic talk. And but really, I mean, they're not telling you what it does and how it's connected to the devil. So that's why a lot of the Freemasons are so in the dark, even though that's their main goal, is to seek the light, is what they say. I mean, they're in the dark because they don't know really what it is they're learning. They're just getting the keys to the box.
Yeah, and one thing this we talked about, you know, like the Freemason video has gotten really popular, I believe, especially there's a lot of older people I saw who were big fans of that. And part of that, I would say, probably would be, too, because you know, you have the older people who talk about my mom said stuff about this before, where like the Masons, you know, the Masons run the world and stuff like that. Do you believe that, or is it some other group? Well, who do you think's behind it all? You said you used to believe the Illuminati ran it all. Who do you believe? Who runs it all now?
Yeah, I mean, I went from the Illuminati to the Rothschilds, just the Soros family, till I realized it's, I mean, it's all just one big religion, and it's definitely Judaism is pretty evil. And you know, it's funny. Yeah, I saw a lot of boomers that really liked the video because boomers, I mean, they like to scapegoat the real issue. They like to they can't imagine that the Jews could possibly be responsible for all this evil in the world. So they like to take individual groups like the Rothschilds or the Bilderbergs or Freemasons. So that's why my goal with the video was not really to blame the Freemasons on running the world, but really to show that they're doing Jewish rituals. They have a Jewish Bible in front of them. They have the Talmud in front of them, their holy book. And that's where all the rituals come from. They stem from the Talmud and Kabbalah. It's all Jewish mysticism at the end of the day. That's all Freemasonry is Jewish mysticism. So if we can wake people up to the realization that that Freemasonry is attached to Judaism, then we can start to recognize what the real issue is. And it's not Freemasonry, it's Judaism.
I mean that's like I said. If you I mean you've watched the video. There's a lot of Jewish symbolism. Didn't they have like Star of David on the wall at one point too? I think in the
Yeah, they
video.
have Star of David on the wall, pentagram.
It's just very. It's very, very, very. Not even strange. It's just straight up. It is just satanic stuff. But yeah. So there is that. I don't think. I'm trying to think. I thought I had something else to say on the topic, but I can't remember. And like I said, that's just how I just forget these things. I'm sorry, but but anyways, we have one other thing too. So that was a lot of your stories there, the things that you've done undercover. Obviously, if you want to see all the things that Kyle, all the stories that he's done, you can follow him on his social medias. I believe it is Kyle Undercover on Instagram, right? I have it. Actually, let me pull it up here. I have it on screen. Let me just pull it up. There you go. Let me uncover it there. There you go. Yeah, Kyle is Undercover on Instagram. You can follow him over there. But real quick, before we head out, we'll be wrapping it up here shortly. But before we head out, I want to discuss this thing. Not really one of your stories, but just something that happened in the news recently, as recent as yesterday. And I have used a tweet about it here. Let me, Jews in New York were spotted like crawling out of sewers and crawling out of tunnels and. What's going on here? What is this all about, you know?
Man, I mean, it's crazy. The story's still unfolding, but I mean, what it looks like is rats crawling out of the sewer system based on video. I mean, you literally have a Jewish man climbing out of the tunnel and scurrying off to the sunlight hitting him or the camera light hitting him. I mean, I don't know what's going on, but they're building these giant tunnels underground in New York City. And they're connected to children's museums. They're connected to women's bathrooms. They have stained mat, bloodstained children's mattresses in the tunnels. Baby carriers. I mean, the list goes on. Somebody said they're connected to a bank. They go under right underneath the bank. So I'm wondering if there's money laundering there. But it seems like they're hitting all the nails perfectly. I mean, they hit every anti-Semitic stereotype that they possibly could.
Insane. Some people, like you said here, I have your tweet up here for everyone to see. You said this on Twitter. The underground Jewish tunnels found in New York are connected to the local children's museum. Very disturbing stuff here, and it is. And people have been pointing out, rightfully so, connections to old FBI case, the Finders case, which I don't know if you're familiar with, but where the FBI uncovered this like large satanic trafficking ring where these people had tunnels leading up to like preschools and whatnot, where they were getting these kids from, what it seems like. Do you think this is, like I said, another example of this?
Oh, I guarantee it. I mean, if you look at some of the Talmudic rituals, I mean, they believe in sex magic with children. It's 100% fact. So the fact that they have baby carriers and children's mattresses and they're going underneath the children's museum, I mean, that's enough proof right there. I would go in there and clean that thing up real quick.
Oh yeah, I
And I mean,
mean,
this isn't just some random synagogue. This is the headquarters for the Chabad Jews. So I mean, this is like their main sanctuary.
because I, like I said, the story is still kind of unfolding. What was funny was I was like out last night. I was at a, like a we had a Christmas party at my work, and I'm just sitting there, and I happened to open my phone, and I just blowing up like Jews have, you know, child trafficking tunnels under New York, and I just see like videos of some Jews crawling out of tunnels. I'm like, what the hell is going on? And I just sit there and like read through Twitter just to figure it out. But the story still is unfolding, as you said. But they uncovered these tunnels from, that led to like the synagogue under New York City. And they were trying to say, from what I've heard, a lot of Jews have tried to run cover for this. They're trying to say that one thing I've heard a lot is that they were secret tunnels from like 2020 when everything was like locked down and like Jews had to like, you know, like go underground, like, you know, get tunnels like just to go to like the synagogue, you know, just to worship. It was like they're trying to make it like a freedom of religion kind of thing, or like anti-lockdown thing, which is a little strange. And they're already like filling up these tunnels too, which is the weird thing. There's not even really like an investigation, what it seems like, going into these tunnels. They're just covering them up. They're like filling them in with concrete now or cement.
Yeah, I've heard stories of apparently people going down in these tunnels years ago to explore, and sometimes the police get involved and they kick you out, and they won't let you in there. They weren't letting reporters in there that were trying to go back in there in 2017. So, I mean, who knows what's going on down there?
I mean, who knows how many tunnels there are? There could be many tunnel systems.
That's one thing I implore everyone to do, is everyone should go out there and look under the synagogues and see what kind of tunnels are under there. I guarantee there's one in every state.
Yeah, go undercover, as you know, in the synagogues. That's where you really should be going, and go look to see if you have tunnels there. You may have to befriend some. You may have to befriend some Jews. You know, maybe pretend you converted to Judaism, and then they'll welcome you in, and then maybe just lie about being Jewish. I don't know. Maybe change your last name or something. But God knows how many of these things exist under these cities, and maybe not even just New York. You know, I believe there's large Jewish groups not just in New York, but I believe there's a large community of them in Florida as well as California. It's like these bigger areas. Like, you know, who knows if this is happening here as well? You know, now I will say, you know, if you do live in these areas, just be careful. Like, I wouldn't recommend going down these tunnels. I'll be honest. At least this is my recommendation. My recommendation is don't go down these tunnels. If you do, don't go alone. That would be my best recommendation. Don't get lost, too. Don't get, you know, kidnapped and raped by Jews. Would be my recommendation. But yeah. So, do you recommend people go undercover? What would you say if someone came across this tunnel? What do you think they should do? Like a secret tunnel.
Oh, I mean, explore it. Get a good video of it. Because I mean, we need to know what's going on down there. Somebody's got to do it. The police aren't going to do it. They're restricted by lots of local laws. The police don't even really get involved. They just seal it up because they think it's already a tunnel that was pre-existing. I mean, a lot of these tunnels, like I think, what is it, Seattle? Seattle had a giant fire. I remember hearing in, I think it was the 1800s or 1900s, and so they had to bury the city and rebuild a new city above it. So, I mean, I think you have a lot of tunnels in Seattle or in other states. So I would definitely look into it. I know a good buddy of mine went underground in some of the tunnels in California and mapped out all the tunnels in the area. And there are some weird stuff going on in a lot of the tunnels in different states. Look at Paris in Paris. So they have the whole catacombs that are miles and miles of endless tunnels. So, I mean, they need to be explored. For sure.
Oh yeah, definitely. But just obviously, if you do that,
yeah, bring guns, guys.
Yeah, be smart about it. Be safe about it. Don't get lost down there. Make sure you have some way where you know to get back. Leave a breadcrumb trail or something. I don't know. Just don't die. Don't die, because we have to get the content. You know, like if you die down there, we won't get the content. You have to give us the content. So, But no, like there is the guy, like I said, who knows how deep this goes. And like you said, they were trying to make it out like it was just, they were just trying to like dig these tunnels just so they can like get into the synagogue. I heard something about how Actually, they're like trying to connect some other like religious building or something to this building through underground tunnels. Even if that's true, why did you have mattresses down there with like strange stains that maybe might appear to be blood stains? I don't know what they are, but also stuff like child, like rocking chair, or like not a rocking chair, but like a high chair, or like a child's like car seat and stuff like that, which is something, because you could say, well, like, a mattress doesn't necessarily mean that there was, you know, doesn't show proof of like a child. Anyone can sleep on a mattress, but like, not everyone can fit in a child's like high chair, you know, or something like that. Something specifically made for a child. So like, you know, why was that down there? You know, why did we see those things down there? And the worst part of it all, like I said, is that there's a cover up for it. They're already filling in these tunnels. They're getting rid of it. They're sweeping under the rug like nothing happened. So it's up to us, you know, to make sure that the story lives on, that people remember this, so it doesn't get memory hold in the next coming days. So, but yeah, like it's very disturbing to me, because if you go back to the Finders case, for example, which I believe was, I could be wrong, but I think it was like 80s, wasn't that when that happened? I believe it was like 80s or 90s when that happened. But when the FBI discovered this, it was some other group, I want to say like the CIA or some other like intelligence group came in and like shut down the FBI investigation to this like satanic, you know, pedophile ring, because they said that the FBI investigating this case was like stepping onto like CIA territory or something like that, basically implying that like they had some involvement in this stuff. And it was it's very strange. Do you think that this is just some Jewish thing, or do you think there was maybe some deeper thing going on, like in the Finders case, where there was some intelligence?
I don't know. The NYPD chief was quick to shut it down and pour cement over it. But yeah, I'd like to see. I'm going to actually try and pull some body camera footage from NYPD to see if any of the officers did go underground and look through some of these tunnels, because I have a feeling these tunnels were a lot longer than people imagine. The tunnels, they're all connected already in New York. So all you got to do is break maybe a 2-foot wall and you're connected to another tunnel that goes off for another 2 miles. So I guarantee you there is more stuff hidden down there. It's a shame to see that they concreted up to filled it up with concrete so quick. I would have liked to see what was going on down there. So hopefully there was some investigations done, but I mean, I guess we'll find that out when more of the FOIA requests get posted. So we'll see.
Yeah, and I think that's the biggest black pill of it all, is that how quickly they covered it up. Like there was no. And that kind of shows, like, there had to be some involvement, because if this was like a surprise to these policemen or, you know, the people in charge there, like, there was no investigation put into, like, this underground, you know, tunnels, you know, throughout the city. Like, you didn't put – so it seems like there was some foreknowledge of this, if they didn't even care to, like, investigate it. You know, they just said, oh, we're covering it up, you know, and it's whatever, you know, kind of thing. It was just, oh, they were just digging some tunnels. Do you think they were down there, you know – you think they were down there just like with shovels? How do you think they got these massive tunnels? Like, are they just shoveling away, or what?
That's what I was hearing. I was hearing that they were taking buckets of dirt and dumping them at a neighborhood lot. So I mean, there's piles of dirt somewhere. I'd like to see where that piles are. And it's funny, I was looking at some pictures, and in New York they have their own, the Jews have their own police and ambulance services. I forget what they call them, but they got voted in by the New York legislative. So they have their own police that show up on scene first. So I'd like to be able to see, I mean, what those police officers saw before NYPD came in, because NYPD eventually did come in. But I think the Jewish police were there first. So who knows?
Hopefully, like I said, hopefully we figure out more about this in the coming days or weeks, because this is something big. You know, this could be, you know, some. I heard something too. I don't know how true this is. I didn't look into it, but I heard something that these tunnels, or the synagogue that it was just like less than a mile from some like building that Jeffrey Epstein owned in New York or something like that too. I didn't look into that claim, but it makes sense. I mean, I wouldn't be surprised if that's true. But if that is true, that's, you know, that's something big as well. But yeah, it's very messed up stuff, very sick, satanic stuff. Make sure you pray about it, and pray that one day these people will, if not on this world, will face justice for it in the next, because this is really messed up, sick stuff. But that's all I have for news stuff. I don't know if you have any other comments before we move to viewer comments here. Did you have anything else?
No,
to add?
I'm good, sorry.
Okay, well, let me pull up this stuff here. Let me fix the camera here. Okay, there we go. Okay, let me pull up this real quick here. Let me close some stuff. Let's see. If my computer will work. Let's see here. So on Instagram. Over on Instagram before the stream, if you follow me over there, I left a little box. You guys were able to ask some questions over there, and we did get a couple questions here. If my my stuff will work now, let me pull it up here. So I'm not gonna name names here, but we had a couple people here. Someone asks, what confrontation that you did was the most keck?
Oh, probably one that I haven't even posted, the ADL. I mean, the ADL when they, confrontation. I confronted this guy who was going to court for raping his two nephews. So it's this gay state legislator in Arizona who about 2 years ago, his nephews came out and was like, hey, this guy raped me. So he had to resign from the state legislator, and he had to go to court for it. And I think he's still on court. He's still on trial right now. It's a long trial, but I decided to catch him when he was coming into trial. And I got a giant poster board of him standing next to the governor, who is also a extreme far leftist. And I asked him, as he was walking up to court, I'm like, why did you rape those children? Did Katie Hobbs, the governor of Arizona, know about your involvement with children? And it was just so funny because the look on his face, he wanted to punch me. And he did body check me on camera, but you can't really see it because of the angle. But yeah, he was so mad. And it was so funny because he couldn't do anything because the camera's rolling. He's going into court. And if he does anything, I mean, it's just going to hurt his case. But man, it was a good time. I love confronting pedophiles.
Yeah. So what video would be like, what is the best, your best thing that you think you've done?
Probably the Freemasons. I mean, that garnished like what, 20 million views total. So, and I gained all my followers from it basically. So that definitely is one of my favorites for sure.
Okay. So someone else on Instagram asks, what is his response being you? What is your response to the allegations that you are the reincarnation of Chick Hicks from Cars? I don't know if you know who that is. The green car with it looks like he has the mustache. Yeah. But yep,
that's me, guys.
Someone else asks here, this is not a very serious question, but someone asks here, do you like cats?
Do I like cats? Yeah, I do. I have a cat somewhere running around. Yeah, his name is Norman. He's named after Norman Bates, the serial killer on the TV show. But yeah, I'm a big cat guy. I grew up liking dogs, but as soon as I got a cat, I'm cat pilled now for sure.
What do you think about if you hang around cats a lot, if you get a lot of cats, you can get like a mind, like a parasite that like mess that like gets in your head because it comes from like cat poop or something like that. What do you think about that?
You know, I believe that because, you know, actually a couple weeks ago at my work, I have to talk with a lot of clients. I'm in the financial industry. And I was talking to a client who has 40 cats in her New York City apartment, one bedroom apartment. And this lady, she sounded very crazy. And so I'm convinced that the cat lady thing is actually, yeah, it's probably some kind of disease they contracted from the animals for sure.
Someone else over here asked on Instagram, he's asking about the, you said that you want reporters in all 50 states. He says, you say female reporters in all 50 states. What about male reporters in all 50 states?
I mean, yeah, I mean, it comes in handy. Eventually, I'm going to need males too for certain types of things. So, yeah, and I mean, at the end of the day, the male can also help me get the female in that state. So, yeah, I mean, send me a message, guys. If any of you are in a state and you want to go undercover, females, I mean, especially, but males too, if you want to do some undercover work for me or get some good camera footage when I need you, I'd like to have a list like that I can categorize with everyone from all 50 states, a guy and a girl, or multiple guys and girls, so I could just call them up and say, hey, there's something going on over here. You want to go and film it? And then, I mean, now with this giant following I have, I can shout you out. I mean, I can't pay you, unfortunately, until my operation becomes bigger. But right now, I can shout you out, and we can grow together. We can grow the America First message. I mean, that's what matters at the end of the day.
So if you have any if you want to get involved in undercover, if you like the idea of undercover journalism, yeah, definitely hit them up. Where can people find you at?
You can message me on Twitter, which is Kyle is based, or message me on Instagram, which is Kyle is undercover.
So I'll ask Carter. I don't know, he's one of the mods, and I saw him in the chat earlier. Hopefully he will link at least some
What
of your
up,
social
Carter?
medias. At least hopefully he'll link some of your social medias over there in the chat, because like I said, I can't put them down below. There's some other I can't read some of these comments. I can't read those.
Let's hear him.
No. I legitimately I don't think you want to hear them.
Okay.
But well, I'll t we're not I'm not gonna read them on here.
No.
But no, if you like I said, if you want to help get involved, definitely go reach out to Kyle on his social medias there, and I'm sure he will help you get set up and let you know. What would you say, like, if someone wanted to start getting into this, like, what would you recommend? Like, what would you tell them? If I, let's say, for example, if I wanted to get involved in this, what would you tell me? How would I start with this?
So the coolest way that I noticed that how I got into it is I would just be sitting here and I'd be reading the news and I'd see Arizona man or Ray Epps lives in Arizona or something like that, or local Arizona man storms the Capitol. And I'd look at it, I'm like, Arizona, wow, I live in Arizona. Why don't I go talk to him? Like, it's all it takes is a conversation, right? It's not that big and scary just to go up to somebody and talk to them. So I mean, that's how you do these confrontational stuff. So anyone, if you're in Michigan, if you're in California and you hear something on the news that's kind of crazy and you hear all of a sudden it's in California, go ask questions. It's not that hard. Just get in your car and go ask questions.
I tried to do something like that a couple of years ago. There was it kind of went. It wasn't like a huge story, but it did it. Like some people talked about it. Like I think the Daily Wire ran a smaller article about it. But there was a this like sex ed summer camp thing happening in Indianapolis, for like kids. And I was gonna go down. I was gonna. I took time off. I went down to Indianapolis, and I was hoping to like do something with this and maybe confront the woman who ran it, but apparently she, because it like went big, she like changed the venue, and I couldn't figure out where it was being held. So unfortunately, we couldn't find like where she was doing it. But no, I've tried my hand. I've tried to do some of this stuff. I'm just not the greatest at it. But yeah. But no, if definitely, like I said, if you have these things happening, because I'm sure things like this are happening in every state. Like even if it's a red state, even if it's a smaller state, you're probably having something happening at the public schools, or something happening in local politics. Something is happening, definitely, because these people are everywhere. And so I would recommend, like you said, get involved as much as you can. Just don't get arrested. Don't I would rec try not to get arrested at least. But yeah.
Yeah, be on the table.
Yeah, be optical, be smart about these things. But yeah, do you have anything else? I mean, do you have any closing comments you want to make to any about anything?
No, just I appreciate you having me on. 07's in chat, guys, for the Big Nick show. We love Big Nick. 07's for Carter Shaw. We love Carter. He's the best. But I appreciate you having me on. It's good to be here.
And
Hopefully, I
where
can come on again.
Oh yeah, most definitely. Where do you have any? Real quick, I don't know how much you could say. Do you have any? You maybe give a little teaser. What's your next big scoop? What's your next big story?
Trying to think what I could say. I'm working on a few projects, a few big ones. I mean, right now it's really just a matter of finding somebody. Right now I'm looking for specifically a female in Florida, Miami, Florida, because I got a very good story that I'm working on there. So if anyone knows anyone, let me know, reach out to me. Also, what am I working on? I want to expose some of these neoconservative media organizations. So you'll see some stuff coming soon for sure.
Well, we'll make sure to look out for that. Like I said, you can find Kyle over on Instagram, Kyle Undercover, and I believe it is it Kyle Undercover as well on Twitter?
If you search Kyle Undercover on either platform, you'll find me, yeah.
Actually, real quick, let me pull up. I almost forgot about this. You can find his. It's like a. It's not Linktree, but it's like a similar thing here. It's
I got banned on
Tapper.
Linktree.
Oh, really? What have you all been banned on? What are the things you've been banned on?
I was banned on Instagram originally, for posting about the Talmud. I was banned on Linktree, banned on PayPal, banned on Twitter, but I was reinstated. That's about it so far.
So you can find this is what it's looking like right here. I will post it in the chat in a second here, but this it is the link is taplink.cc/KyleAZ here, and I will, like I said, I'll link it in a second here. But yeah, I'm glad we were able to do this. I'm glad I had you on here because, like I said, I appreciate it too. It does mean a lot when I have like people asking me to come on the show. It's like it means something. I guess I'm a little bigger than I thought I was, but I do appreciate it. I do appreciate it. But let's see here. But I think that's about it for tonight. Like I said, make sure you like, subscribe, make sure you follow. Let me post the link in the chat real quick. Make sure you follow Kyle on all the social medias when you can. Whenever social media platform you're on. I will be back hopefully next week around the same time with maybe hopefully a new guest on as well, so stay tuned for that. But until next time, you guys, all of you guys, you have a wonderful night.
Good night, everyone.
And now, folks, it's time to say good night. We sincerely appreciate your patronage and hope we've succeeded in bringing you an enjoyable evening of entertainment. Please drive home carefully and come back again soon. Good night.